Well, good evening, folks. Here we are. Two more days of 2020. though many of us are looking forward to what 2021 has in store for us. But thanks for joining me here on this Wednesday night. Delighted to have you with us as we share just a few moments in God's Word and have a time of prayer together. I want to just pause and thank so many. Thank individuals that were here Monday morning to take down our Christmas decorations, put them up, organize them. That way we'll be ready for Christmas 2021. Special thanks to Robbie and Barbara Lanier. They kind of coordinated our efforts on this past Monday. Did a great job in making sure everything is put back in the right place. I want to say special thanks also to Ken and Pat Merrill, Brother Donald Jones, Brother Casey Jones as well, Mary Lanier. I want to say special thanks to her. Kirsten, and Abby Howerton. Thank you as well. Had great help again this past Monday. Say a special appreciation to those. A couple of our Christmas committee was having to be quarantined, so they weren't able to assist. I want to make sure I did not leave anybody out. Wilson Merrill. Can't leave Wilson out. Praise God. Brother Wilson Merrill helped out as well. I want to encourage you. Christmas is behind us. I realize that. But let's continue the thoughtfulness. Let's continue the generosity and the love that we share on Christmas. You can do that. Many of you that's coming on site Sunday after Sunday, thank you for your faithfulness. Or maybe you're watching online. If you're watching online, come by and get your Christmas cards. And those that's here, if you notice some cards in your class here in the sanctuary, Do us a favor. Take those cards, make a visit, and let them know that we're missing them here and that we're praying for them, that we're here for them. All right? Hope you'll be with us this coming Sunday, January the 3rd, the first Sunday of 2021. We're going to be sharing together from James, I think a very practical book. James has been signified as the Proverbs of the New Testament. We're going to be looking at James and how we can have a better plan for a better year. A better plan for a better year. So hope you'll join us this Sunday, 8:45 Sunday School, 10 a.m. worship. If you can't join us here on site, hope you'll join us. Hope you'll join us on our Facebook, on our website. All right? Again, delighted if you're visiting tonight, we're glad to have you a part of our time in God's Word. And so, hope you have your Bibles. We're going to be in Ephesians chapter 4. It's a very important verse as we come to the conclusion of 2020. All right? We're going to pray together, and then we're going to get into God's Word. All right? Let's pray. All right? Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for your presence. We thank you for Christmas 2020. We thank you, Father, for all that you have done and doing, Father, in our church, in our lives. God, even with this coronavirus, Father, you're still at work. You're not surprised by this. You're still on the throne. You're still in control. You're still in charge. So, God, help us to put our trust and faith in you. God, help us, Lord, as Christians, as a church, whatever the church that those have joined us tonight go to, whether it's Fork or wherever, that you have called us to care. God, help us to know, equip us, direct us on how we can practically care for each other and for your church and for those, God, who need the gospel. Father, we love you. We pray all this in Christ's name. Amen and amen. Got your Bibles. We're going to be in Ephesians 4 in a few moments, but I shared with you back in the spring, all right, as all this started, that your deacons and myself and leadership has come up with a vision for not just 2020, but 2021. That vision is right there. That vision is this, is that first of all, we'll know God, okay? know him intimately, know him personally. How do we do that? Get in his word. Be here worshiping with God's people, okay? We know him. We find freedom. Freedom from sin, freedom from this world that says that, you know, that this takes us everywhere except to God's word and God's will. We find freedom, okay? And then we discover our purpose, all right? We're discovering our purpose here at Fork, all right? And you need to discover the purpose you have in your life. We're discovering a new purpose here because of COVID-19 that we're able to branch out and do many other ministries, okay? And get the gospel message to people we couldn't even imagine before all this took place. And then lastly, make a difference. Listen, folks, we can't just sit back and just take it all in. We got to get out there and make a difference. How are you making a difference in your family? How are you making a difference in your community? And yes, even in your church. So I encourage you in that. You're going to be hearing more about this in coming days and weeks, hopefully, to remind us of our vision, our 2020-21 vision. All right? Good deal. All right. Tonight, we just want to take a few moments as we begin a new year, all right? And as you know, in this new year, on social media, on TV, we are going to be inundated with what? Advertising. Mainly advertising for what? Quick weight loss or minimum exercise to lose weight. Went to Body Pump this morning, and the instructor said, "Hey, we have to sign up for our classes." And she said, "Look, y'all better sign up quick, because you know what happens in the new year? Everybody comes back to the Y. Everybody comes back to the classes because they want to get in shape quick, you know." Well, quick weight loss is kind of an oxymoron, isn't it? Okay, you combine two words that are to complete opposite, like a definite maybe, like the living dead, like a poor millionaire, all right? A wise fool, jumbo shrimp, okay? How about this, military intelligence, praise God. Here's one, customer service. There's an oxymoron. Or how about this, a reliable computer. That's definitely. You see, folks, we've got to really work at it to keep in shape. We've got to eat right, which I need help with that. And we've got to exercise, intense exercise. Now, I'm doing all right there. Eating part? Nah, like my Bluebell. Okay. Other things, all right? And my Dr. Peppers, all right? And Cheerwine. So, but you know, it takes effort. It takes effort to care for our bodies, right? But you know, also, it takes effort to care for this body, the body, those that's watching, those that's come to our church, those that we connect with and fellowship with and worship with, all right? So, you know, the only way to gain strength and to gain health is to do what's right. And as far as our bodies, as far as our church and the Christians as well, okay? All right? We've got to strengthen our church body. I came across this a while back, that what makes a good church? I'm going to read this to you for a second. What makes a good church? This was found in the Salvation Army Church in St. Louis, Missouri. Okay? And it says this. What makes a good church? Here's what makes a good church. If all the lazy people get up, if all the sleepy people wake up, if all the discouraged folks cheer up, if all the gossiping folks shut up, praise God. If all the dishonest folks fess up, if all the estranged folks make up, if all the depressed folks look up, if all the disgusted folks sweeten up, if all the lukewarm folks fire up, I like that. If all the sanctified folks just show up, all right? If all the leading folks will live up, if all the vowing folks will pay up, if all the shouldering folks will stand up. I think that's great. You know, the word church is redeemed in the New Testament. It comes from a Greek word, ekklesia, which means the called out ones. So, by using Paul's admonishing to the Ephesians, in Ephesians chapter 4, he's admonishing us as well as God's people, okay? He's admonishing us as we begin a new year, as we deal with this COVID, as we continue to deal with this COVID-19. No matter what, we've got to care. I want to use the CARE, the acronym CARE, C-A-R-E, to help us remember and to help us see how we can be sure that we are a good church and that we are a dedicated follower of Christ, all right? I want us to look at that, all right? And see how, especially us here, here the body of Christ here at Fort Baptist, all right? As we begin a new year, how we here at Fort Baptist Church, how we could produce strength for our body. How can we make our body strong even with this sickness, even through this pandemic that's going around? How can we be strong? How can we be strengthened? We can by simply C-A-R-E. Okay? All right? Well, C, first of all, stands for committed to Christ. All right? All right? This is becoming true indeed to our calling. That's what that is. All right? If you have your Bibles, we're in Ephesians chapter 4. Verse 16 is the main verse we're going to look at in our study tonight. All right? Verse 16 says, for him, everybody say him, for him, the whole body is joined and held together. All right? That verse there, for us to care for others, and we have to understand God's calling us together to be committed to him. We can't care for others, okay, until we really care, indeed care for Christ, all right? We have to care indeed for him. George W. Truett was the pastor of First Baptist Church in Dallas, Texas. Vicki and I went to Southwestern Seminary, Southwestern Baptist Theological Seminary, supported by your cooperative program gifts. Thank you for that, by the way, for providing for my seminary degree. But, you know, at Southwestern, there is the Truett Auditorium, all right? And that's where we all gather for chapel. That's where I first saw my bride there in the chapel there at Truett Auditorium. And he was the only pastor, okay, that any of the buildings is named after. All the buildings around Southwestern named after professors and so forth. He's the only non-academic person there at Southwestern that named after him. Well, of course, Dr. Truett was at his deathbed, was very ill, and he couldn't preach anymore. But the people wanted to hear, and people wanted to hear from their pastor. So you know what they did? They brought a microphone. Of course, this was way back in the early 1900s. They brought a microphone in, okay, and they had him in, and they had speakers in the First Baptist Church, Dallas, Texas, around. And you know what? Everybody in that auditorium, full to the capacity, set in complete silence, hearing what Dr. George W. Truett had to say. You see, folks, he was committed to Christ. He was committed as a follower of Christ, you see. And that's why Ephesians 4:16 says straightforward there, okay? It says straightforward there. Is that the whole body depends on him, on Christ. That's where it all starts. That's where it all ends, folks, is we depend indeed on him. All right? The mark of the Christian who's committed to Christ, okay? The mark of the Christian who's committed to Christ, all right, is one who is supremely concerned about exalting Christ, not himself. So as we begin a new year, we've got to be totally concerned, totally passionate about exalting Christ. Not ourselves, not our church, or we're, you know, up on the hill, whatever. No, We need to exalt Christ no matter what. And no matter what circumstance we find ourselves in, COVID, the unrest, financial situations, health situations, we've got to exalt Christ in everything we do. I love what Jesus says in John 12, 32. He says, if I be lifted up from the earth, I will draw all men unto me. You say, Robert, that's not happening. Maybe not happening now, but it will happen. We've got to be committed to this verse right here. We've got to lift up the name of Jesus. So acronym C, committed to Christ. All right? Committed to Christ. Second is we have to be active. Active involvement. Got to get involved, folks. Active involvement has to do with this right here. Unity. Unity. Look at verse 16 again. It says, from him, the whole body, get that, the whole body is joined and held together by every supporting ligament. Note the condition there, okay? The whole body joined, knit together, all right? By what? By every supporting element. This right there means everybody is working together. Everybody has to work together, okay, to get things done. We've got, folks, we've got to be unified. The contribution of each part of the unit is important in obtaining the full strength of the church. You know, it's been said that the, you know, a chain is only as strong as what? The weakest link. Our church is only as strong as the link, is the weakest member. So, folks, we've got to keep that in mind as we move into 2021. You know, Jesus once said in Mark 3:25, he says, if a house is divided against itself, that house can't stand. You see, folks, the devil knows, you know, and John 10 talks about this, the devil comes to steal, kill, and destroy. He knows he can steal, kill, and destroy our church, our families, if he can divide us, if he can divide marriages, if you can divide people in God's church, he knows. Let's don't let him do that, folks. As we begin a new year, let's be together. Yeah, none of us are perfect. You know, we all fall in many ways, all right? We're not perfect, but we've got to stick together. We've got to be unified in Christ. Ephesians 4:3, he says, make every effort. He said, make every effort, he says, all right? To keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of what? Peace. That's how we can be unified. Peace. Establish peace, you see. That word to keep there indicates that it's fragile, all right? It's fragile there, and it needs to be guarded. It needs to be kept. It needs to be kept safe. It needs to be kept. Carefully, rather. See, we're not told to create unity. God's already done that through the cross. He's created the unity. But we have to preserve it. All right? We have to preserve it. We have to keep it. All right? You know, God wants to use people, all right, to speak to us. You know, one of the reasons I feel God has allowed me to be in the ministry for this long is that I've made an effort, a conscious effort to be held accountable by, yes, God and his word, but with flesh and blood too, with people, okay? Proverbs 11:14, one of my favorite verses of all the Old Testament. It says, for the lack of guidance, a nation falls, but many advisors makes victory sure. Isn't that awesome? Many advisors. And, Bo, let me tell you, I got many advisors here. I got one sitting in the office this week has been with me, Miss Pat Marilyn. She's been great. Susie, of course, is another one. I got my deacons, especially my chairman and others that holds me accountable. It's not afraid to tell me what I don't want to hear. You know, if it hurt my feelings, I'd go to Lowe's and get a letter and get over it, praise God. Okay, come on, somebody. Also, Proverbs 15:22 says, Plans fail for a lack of counsel, but many advisors, they succeed. See there? Two verses right there in Proverbs reinforces this, that we need to be unified and we need to help each other, hold each other accountable, all right? Because many of us have tunnel vision. We don't see where our weaknesses are. So, how are we doing as a church? How are we doing as a church as in this active involvement, you see? How are we doing in sharing the love of God? It's a legitimate question, folks. How are we doing it loving, you know? Love means, you know, you before me, okay? All right? How are we doing in loving each other, forbearing with one another, and forgiving, praise God, with one another, helping one another? You see, every person in this church, not just the pastor, not just the staff, not just the deacons, every person matters in this church. In a few moments, I'm going to be praying for every person on this prayer list, okay? Every person matters here, folks. You can understand that. If you're not connected somehow, all right? If you're just, you know, yeah, it's great that we have this online, but the weakness of this online, it kind of makes us lazy. It makes some of us, we'll just stay home and watch it online, you know, watch it on Facebook or on a website. We need to have this because some are out of town and some are staying home because of illnesses and sickness. But folks, listen, there's nothing like being here, eyeball to eyeball, connecting with God's people. Okay? All right? Listen, you won't really experience the love, the intimacy, the joy if you're not here. Okay? We need to be here. You know, I have people telling me all the time, visitors coming, we get these connection cards here all the time, and I got people telling me all the time, man, you got a loving church there, Pastor. You got a caring church. Our fall festivals, our Bible school. But just recently, our Road to Bethlehem, we did this event. We had over 200-some-odd people come through. We had people giving our co-ed one class was greeting people with Santa Claus. They were giving them money, saying, thank you for caring for our community. Thank you. We, of course, gave that to Lottie Moon. But you know, listen, folks, we got to keep this up. We can't fail in this, folks. We can't fail in showing love. This is nothing, okay? We can come short on, all right? Let's commit ourselves again and again and again. Listen, we're going to fall. We're going to fail, as I talked about Monday. We've got to be resilient, especially in actively being involved in God's church, in God's kingdom. Okay, where are we at? Care, committed to Christ. A, active involvement. And then what? R, guess what? Responsible membership. Hello. Okay. Responsible membership. Responsible membership is using simply, okay, it's going back to our theme here, to go back to that. Our theme there, okay, discovering our purpose, all right? It's going back to that. That's responsible membership, all right? Responsible membership. Ephesians 4:16, again, it says it grows up and builds itself up, what we talked about, in love as each part does its work, okay? What's this phrase mean? It speaks to a given spiritual gift. You see, folks, every one of us have been given a spiritual gift to exercise. I don't have any spiritual gifts. If you're saying that today, tonight, then you may want to check yourself. You may want to see if you're truly a child of God. Because if you're a child of God, if you're a follower of Christ, you're a disciple, you have a spiritual gift. You have that, all right? What's God given you that he wants you to use for his glory, all right? What's God given you tonight that he wants to you to use. Maybe some of your talents, some of your abilities. He wants to use those abilities, you see, to help God's church. Prime example, this past Sunday, we had a few issues here, praise God. Come on, somebody. We had a few issues here. It happens in older church, in any church. We had heat issues. Well, Ricky Rummage, one of our awesome deacons, he's expertise what? In heating and air. Boom, he was here working on it Sunday morning early. All right? We got many others. Keith Mason, our electrician. We have issues with lights, whatever. Boom, he's on. I can go on down the line of people who have been given gifts. Okay? Brother Mike Livengood has been, you know, as our church treasurer. He's an accountant. Been given. So his gift, of course, is our finances and so forth. I can go on and on about this. All right? But how does God want you to demonstrate your faith? Okay? By giving your time, your talents, your treasure. As an expression, not a love for this pastor, not a love for his church, okay, but a love for him. That's why we're doing this, folks. Yesterday morning, I was able to share me and Kurt and Bonnie Stakeman. We went to the detention center there, the David Detention Center, and met with around 20 or so officers there. And just share the love of Christ. We gave them, of course, the blue bags. And by the way, that is taken off in other communities. People are contacting us. What are y'all doing about this? How did y'all do this? We want to do that, okay? It's going to Iredell County, Forsyth County. And Bonnie's dream and my dream as pastor is this will go out throughout the whole state of North Carolina. We're praying to that end. But they're encouraging them, all right? And as an expression of our love and our appreciation for our men and women in blue, okay? So that was a demonstration, all right? By giving that and sharing and encouraging them to do that. Jesus says Matthew 26 through 28. He says, Jesus instructing his disciples, he says, not so with you. Instead, whoever wants to become great among you must be your servant. And whoever wants to be first must be your slave. Just as the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and give his life a ransom for many. Okay? Let's look at that more closely there in verse 26. It says there, not so with you. You see that there? Not so with you. All right? That's so important verse. That's so important passage there. Words there. You know what he's saying? You know what he's saying there? Jesus is saying, listen, I have a heart for you that you can be better than you are. Okay? You don't have to stay where you are. You see, folks, Jesus has a heart for us to pursue greatness. Even though the world is constantly teaching me to do it or you to do it a certain way, okay? All right? He's persuaded better things for us. Notice he says, whoever wants to become great. All right? Go back to that verse. So whoever wants to become great. All right? See that? All right, it's important. He doesn't discourage greatness. He wants us to be great in all whatever we do. He wants us to, you know, do it with all of our heart, with all of our, you know, mind, soul, spirit, whatever. He wants us to be great. All right, okay. But sadly, the desire for greatness is not wrong, but it does cause people to desire wrongly. All right, say it again. The desire for greatness is not wrong. But it does cause us to desire wrongly, to desire the wrong thing in the wrong way, to desire the wrong amount, all right? That's why Jesus says, whoever wants to be great among you, what? Must be your servant. You see, folks, in God's eyes, the greatest person is the greatest servant, okay? Who's the greatest person in your family? If it has to do with servant, I can tell you the greatest person in my family. My girls will testify. It's their mama. It's my wife. I mean, you talking about a servant. She serves not only our family, but those around her, her clients that she interprets for. She's always taking them stuff. Not me. I hate to say it. Not me. She's got me beat by a long shot. Okay. All right. Who's the greatest? Okay. Who's the greatest in our church? Who's the greatest in your at your work? The greatest is, in the eyes of God, is the greatest servant. I would suggest to you that your Christian life will never make sense until you learn this concept, until you learn to serve and to commit to actually getting up off the back end and doing something, serving, serving, serving. You know, this past Monday, we had these 10 or so here working. Man, we were laughing. They were cutting up. They were talking. I could really sense the joy of Jesus in every one of their lives. You know why? Because they were serving. Putting up Christmas decorations. Yeah, that's serving. Jesus said, the least you do to these, my brother, you've done it to me. It's the least, you see. Even putting up Christmas decorations is serving. And man, we had some great servants here this past Monday. You know, folks, if your Christian life is just an obligation, if it's just something you go through and you get the check mark, listen, folks, you won't find joy. You won't experience all that God wants you to experience. Here at Fort, for the past almost 17 years, I've introduced a concept of stakeholdership. What is stakeholdership? Stakeholdership is having an emotional stake in the health and direction of God's church, okay? Or you can adapt that to your company. A stakeholdership is you have an emotional stake in the health and direction of that company, all right? Folks, when we have an emotional stake in the health of Fort Baptist Church, we could care less who gets credit. We want to get the job done. We're going to serve. We're going to work until it's done. Care. Folks, as we begin a new year, we've got to care. Committed to Christ. Active involvement. Responsible membership. But lastly, encouragement. Encouragement. All right? We got to be encouraged. We got to encourage one another. Paul is the person who speaks with great encouragement. Look at verse 29 of Ephesians 4. He says, don't let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouth. That's not just cuss words. That's negativity. Oh, it's, you know, the sky is falling. Oh, this pandemic. Oh, we can't be here. We can't do this. No. Don't let it. Don't let it come out of your mouth. He said, but only what is helpful for the building up others up, according to their needs, that it may benefit those who listen. See, folks, he doesn't mention a negative person at all here. Okay? All through his letters, he very seldom mentions anybody negative in a negative way. Paul seeks to be positive. All right? And our problem today, folks, is many believers of Jesus who always, sadly, we seek the negative of people. All right? Hey, look, just like your children. You can look at your children. Man, my girls are growing up. Boom. I could point out what they were doing wrong. I had to look sometimes, see what they're doing right. It's easy for you to look, see what I'm doing wrong. You have to look a little harder to see what I'm doing right. Okay? It's easy for us to do that. That's our nature, you see. Every Christian, you see, folks, all of us are prone to lose heart at times, all right? I want to close with this scripture that I encourage two precious ladies in Texas, Darlene Swindell and her daughter, Patty. She is in ICU there at Moses Cone there in Houston. Not Moses Cone, I'm sorry. A hospital there in Houston. In very serious condition. ICU, and the doctor says is critical next several days. We appreciate your prayers. And I share this verse. I want to close with you tonight. that hopefully will encourage you to hang in there, to keep doing what you know is right and you know what God wants you to do. And that's 2 Corinthians 4:16 and 8 through 18. Don't lose heart, Paul says. Though outwardly we are wasting away, yet inwardly we are being renewed day by day. For our light momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal glory. COVID, cancer, heart issues, depression. I could go on and on. Momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal glory that far outweighs them all. So we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but what is unseen. For what is seen is temporary, but what is seen is eternal. Isn't that true? This life, folks, is temporal. And I love Darlene, and I pray the best, but I know no matter what, she's going to be okay because she loves Jesus. And if she goes, she'll be reunited with my dear camp director, buddy, mentor for many years, Jim Swindell. See, God has allowed me to be on the front lines, have the front seat to death and dying. And, you know, death doesn't really bother me a whole lot at this point because I know those that know Christ as their Savior and Lord, they're going to a better place. We're just passing through here. James 4:14 talks about that. That we're just a vapor that appears a little time, vanishes away. Yeah, we hurt. We want to live. But folks, listen, when's my time? I'm out of here. I don't know about you, but I am out of here. All right? Amen. So let's care. Let's commit to Christ. Let's be actively involved. Let's be responsible in our membership, okay, in our family. Let's be responsible, but also let's be encouraged. Let's encourage one another when we see the day of God approaching. All right? Amen. All right, we're going to go to the Lord in prayer. All right? What I want to do now is to want you to know that I'm recording this. I don't know if I'll be available tonight or not, but hopefully I will. If I will, I'm going to come online with you and see your comments and make some comments. And if you want to make some comments, that'll be great. We'd love to pray for you and love to, I love to pray for you privately, you know, in my prayer time. So if you have a prayer request, feel free to leave it online. I'm going to miss not being live with you though. But I am going to pray tonight. We're going to pray for every person, okay, on our prayer list, all right? And if you know some of these, you pray for them. And if you're not on here, want somebody on here, you can call Miss Pat Merrill tomorrow. You can call Pat Merrill, or you can go to our website. There it is. Go to our website, and you can post a prayer request there. That will come straight to Miss Pat or Susie next week when she comes back. And we'll definitely add you indeed to our prayer list. All right? All right. Let's go to God in prayer. Father, we thank you, Lord, that you have given us, as Paul gave the Ephesians, you have given us a mandate to care, to be committed to you, to be actively involved, to be responsible in our membership, and yes, to be encouraged and to encourage one another. So God, I want to pray for these, and that God, that they will be encouraged. And Lord, even though they may not be watching, but Lord, they may sense that there's people praying for them. I pray, Lord, for these now. I pray for Ada Mae Carter. Thank you, Lord, for the prayer warrior that she's been for this church for decades. Continue to bless her in that nursing home. For Adam Shull, a co-worker, Brother Ted Boger. You know his needs. I pray you'll bless him. I pray for Miss Betty Turner, Lord, who is Stan Turner's mom. Thank you, Brother Stan, and God and his faithfulness, but also his faithfulness, not just to his church, but his faithfulness to his mom and taking care. For Beverly Phelan, I pray for her, Beverly and Carl. God, I just pray you continue to meet their needs according to your will. God, we do pray for Brother Bill Alive and Good and Miss Jean. Thank you, Lord, for their faithfulness through decades here at Fork. But God, we thank you that, Lord, I spoke to Gene not too long ago, a week or so ago, and he's doing pretty good. So continue to give him strength, give him health. For Buffy Hoff, the salvation. God, I pray for her salvation, Lord. I pray for Miss Mary Lanier as she encourages Buffy. And I pray that, God, through Miss Mary, that you will, that she might receive and believe in the gospel of Jesus Christ. For Butch Brooks, who has leukemia, who's a friend of Richard and Anna Yance, I pray you'll bless him. God, for Brother Casey Jones, I'm just at awe of how you are sustaining him, how you are strengthening him. Lord, if people could really see the life of Casey Jones, of the servant heart that he is, and all that he's gone through with his treatments and everything, how he remains to be faithful, how he was here Monday, struggling, but working. God bless him. Bless him. Help him through these treatments, Lord, in a special way. For Brother Charlie Wood, there at the Moxville Senior Center, Senior Living Center, I just pray you bless Charlie and God help Vicki and myself and others that can reach out to him. I know that it's discouraging. They're being deaf there in that nursing home and people not able to communicate with him. The Lord just continue to bless him. For Crystal Barney, pray, Lord, that you will direct her. Be with Grady as he cares for his wife. God, just meet their needs according to your will. God, we do pray for church unity, as I just shared in Ephesians 4. We pray you'll continue to bring our church together in unity. Father, especially through this pandemic. Father, I praise you for those that's been so faithful to you in attending and giving and using their gifts, even through this pandemic, that we're able to have Sunday school. We're able to have children to worship. We're able to have worship. We're able to have youth. Because of that, Lord, this is the unity, Lord, of your church here. For Donna Jones, I pray you'll bless her as, Father, I know that it's hard to even get out of bed these days. And I pray you'll bless her as she continues her treatments. Give her strength, give her peace, and give her hope, Lord Jesus. For Brother Don Bailey, just pray you'll bless him, Lord Jesus, in a special way. Meet his needs according to your will. God, help him to know that, Lord, that his church is praying for him in these days. God, you'll meet his needs. Bless Brittany, his daughter, as she cares for her dad. For Dylan Cranfield, we praise you, Lord. We just got news that, excuse me, he's coming home this week. So, Lord, bless Debbie, Lord, Jesus, in a special way. God, help her and Dylan, help her and Kobe as they take care of Dylan as he comes home. Miss Elizabeth Hendricks, just bless her. I know that she's still mourning the loss of her dear husband. Bless her and Father Diane and James and Wayne as they care for Miss Elizabeth. For Fanny Balford, Brother Gray Balford's mother in Somerset, just bless her in a very special way. Bless Gray as he cares for her. God bless Brother Felix Rummage. We thank you, Lord, for Brother Felix. And I know he's discouraged, because he can't get out and go where he likes to go and where he's always going. So, Lord, bless him. Father, bless Francis Wilkinson. God, there at Brookshire, there in Clemens. Brookstone, excuse me, in Clemens. God bless Vicki and Eddie as they care for her. And God, I just thank you, Miss Francis. What a sweet, sweet spirit. I visited with her a month or so ago, or a while back, before all this pandemic started going. And Father, she's a sweet, sweet lady. So God, may her sweetness be shared with others, that she may be a testimony there, Father, in the nursing home. For Brother Frank Looper, recovering from foot surgery, pray you'll bless him. Bless Jennifer as he cares for her, as she cares for him. God, for Frida Shelman, knee surgery, Miss Ann Barnhart's sister. Bless Miss Frida in a very special way. God bless Miss Gail Campbell. Thank you for her. And for Larry, continue to meet her needs according to your will. For Greg Gobble, son-in-law of Carl and Brenda Robinson. Lord, just bless him, Lord, with all that he's going through. God, Harper Evans, I pray for him as he's recovering from open-heart surgery. Johnny and Evelyn Watt's granddaughter, pray you'll bless her and very special way. For Jackie McKnight, pray, Lord, for Tim McKnight's mom. Just meet her needs according to your will. For Josh Walzer, Lord, I know he's dealing with cancer. So, Lord, meet his needs. Bless Kent and Sandy as they care for their son there. For Miss Julie Seacrest, I thank you for her. And God, how she continues to stay in contact with us, even though she's moved to Louisville. Just bless her in God in a very special way. For Kenan Miner, Gray and Ruby Nell's grandson, just bless him in a very special way. For Kelly Walker, who has cancer, who's a friend of Tiffany Toggart, we pray you'll meet her needs according to your will. For Kelly Head, I just pray, Lord, for Kelly, who has pancreatic and lung cancer, the niece of Libby Merrill, just meet her needs. And Father, I know this cancer is very, very tragic. Just somehow heal her according to your will. For Kenneth Howell, thank you that he's at home. Continue to bless him and lead and guide, direct him, and Miss Julie as well. For Kenny McGinnis, Alice Wilson's brother, who has Parkinson's, just bless him, Lord Jesus, in a special way. For Laura Barnhart, bless her. And Leslie Blackwelder, thank you for his faithfulness, being a great prayer warrior. Bless Audrey as she cares for her dad, Father, in his days ahead. For Mandy Bailey, recovering from surgery, is Tim and Sherry McKnight's sister-in-law. Continue to meet her needs. Miss Maxine Hendricks, she's had surgery in recent weeks, is continuing to help her in her recuperation. Ophelia Kepley, who is Barbara Lanier's sister. We pray you bless Ophelia in a very special way, meet her needs. For Parker Bailey, we've been praying for Parker for months, if not years. Just thank you, Lord, for sustaining him. Of course, Parker is Tim and Sherry McKnight's nephew, so bless him. For Miss Patty Morton, I spoke to Brother Mike, and she's doing a lot better. She's a little confused at times. So, Lord, help her with that medication and all, and help her mind be clear. Bless Mike and Melody as they care, indeed, for his mom. For Phyllis Mills, cancer, a friend of Jane Jones, bless her in a very special way. For Polly Lagle, who's at Somerset, who is Paula Seifert's mother, continue to meet her needs, especially in the passing of her husband recently. So God, give Paula an extra amount of your grace and compassion, indeed, for her mom. For Sandy Davis, Lord, I pray you'll just help her. And it's Helen Freetag's niece, and meet her needs. For Sarah Seifert, Miss Sarah, truly a great, faithful a warrior here in our church. Faithful follower who've been so dedicated to this church, not years, but for decades. Just bless her. For Shelby Caudill, Crystal Barney's mother, continue to meet her needs. For Steve Ford, who has colon cancer, is Ned Desarne's brother-in-law. Father, we've been praying for him for a good while as well. Just meet his needs. Susan Harvey, I pray you, has breast cancer. A friend of Tim McKnight, bless her. As well as Swanson Gordon, who is Crystal Barney's uncle. Pray for Ted Bogers. He continues to recover from his heart surgery. Thank you, Lord, for the answered prayer on his behalf. For Teresa Huggins, pray that Susie Dowell's sister, who has cancer, that you'll heal her and you'll encourage her, Father, as she deals with this dreaded disease of cancer. For Todd Kimmel, nephew of Richard and Ann Yance, just bless him, as well as Tony Nichols, who's Helen Truel's grandson. Father, I pray right now for the unsaved. I pray for those that may be even watching this tonight that don't know you. Lord, they need to do the C in commitment, in care, excuse me. They need to commit their life to Christ. For Wayne Carter, Adam A. Carter's son, who's going through dialysis, bless him. Wendy Turner, continue to bless her. She's recovering from her foot surgery. Thank you for that. Brother Stan was able to be with us this past Sunday as she stayed home. But Lord bless Wendy in a very special way. God, but last but not least, I want to pray for my sweet lady in Texas, Miss Darlene Swindell.
Father, she is your choice servant. She loves you. She unconditionally loves her family, even though some of her families have not returned that love. But she still loves them anyway. So, Father, sustain Darlene. God, be with those doctors and nurses there in Houston. And God, meet her needs according to your will. Father, if it's your will, return her to her health. Father, whatever your will is, I know Darlene, I know Patty, I know Dan, her son, they submit to your will. And they'll be faithful to you no matter what, because they love you and they know that whatever happens, that their mother, my sweet lady, is in your hands. Father, we love you. Pray all this in Christ's name. Amen and amen. Again, thanks for joining me. Sorry I'm not able to be live tonight, but hopefully I could be on wherever I'm at. I can kind of come and watch and see some of your responses and maybe respond to that. But I hope you will be with us this coming Sunday as we look at a better plan, better year, 2021. Better plan, better year, 2021. All right? So you'll be with us. And not here on site, be here online. We'd love to have you. God bless you. A lot going on. Let's be faithful in our attendance, okay, in our time, in our talents, in our tithe. All right? God bless you. On behalf of Vicki, I want to wish you a blessed, blessed new year. Hang around. A few announcements I want to share with you.
Your name is victory. All praise will rise to Christ our King. Your name is victory. All praise will rise to Christ our King.
Probably know I'm done. Of defeat.